Okay, I guess Joy Reid must have got her marching orders as far as MSNBC is concerned. I want you to note the interview she does with Tad Devine and how attacking, in my words, she is versus the interview that she does with Karen Finley. Now, Karen Finley and she are friends. So that could have a little bit to do with it. But my feeling is, even though parts of MSNBC seem like they're pro Bernie Sanders, MSNBC is definitely pro Hillary Clinton.
Sanders for President, senior advisor. Tad, thank you so much for being here. Appreciate it. Good to see you. All right, let's just jump right into it. Paul Krugman wrote a pretty scathing New York Times column.
He's written a few. 15 of them, okay?
He's reeling them off. He's reeling them off.
He really loves Bernie.
He's not feeling the burn. Yeah. In this one, he essentially asks whether Bernie Sanders is becoming a Bernie bro, the infamous Bernie bros. I'll read you a clip of what he says. He says, the way that Senator Sanders now is campaigning raises serious character and values issues. Recent attacks on Mrs. Clinton as a tool of the fossil fuel industry are just plain dishonest and speak of a campaign that has lost its ethical moorings.
And I haven't seen this, so, but before you get an answer here, Hillary Clinton is pro-fracking, okay? Fracking is part of the fossil fuel industry, and it's a bad part of the industry, okay? Bernie and most of the other progressives out there are anti-fracking, so for this guy to say that Clinton, okay, the guy that wrote the article now, for him to say that Clinton is not a tool of the fossil fuel industry, well, hell, if she wasn't, she'd be anti-fracking. So that's bullshit.
The Sanders campaign become too negative and really focused mainly on essentially destroying Hillary Clinton.
No. Mr. Krugman should stick to economics, okay, instead of pseudo-psychology, which is what that column is all about. This campaign has two candidates, two strong candidates, who have big differences on big issues. And that's what we should debate, and we hope we do in New York. I mean, listen, how we fund campaigns is one of the most important issues in American politics today. After a Citizens United decision, the campaign landscape changed. And if you fund your campaigns with massive donations from Wall Street, which Hillary Clinton does, you're going to be beholden to them if you're elected president.
But how does that square with the fact that Barack Obama, the current president of the United States, funded his campaign with Wall Street donations, among other things, in 2008?
Okay, let me answer that question for you, okay? Barack Obama took a lot of Wall Street money and banking money. The quid pro quo on that one is when they busted the banks and they paid those fines, $5 billion, I guess, for J.P. Morgan Chase. Citibank also paid a huge fine. That was just money, okay? That was just money. And guess who ends up paying that $5 billion? The depositors, okay? We're the ones that end up paying that fine. They should have and could have gone further and prosecuted the heads of those banks and other financial institutions personally, okay? They could have prosecuted them and won convictions. So Obama stopped the prosecution of these guys so that they wouldn't see jail time. So there you go, I just connected the dots. Their campaign contributions kept them out of jail.
Essentially, that he was morally disqualified.
No, I'm not. And, you know, I think if President Obama were running in 2000, if Hillary Clinton had defeated him, as she had attempted to do in 2008, and he were running for president today, the way it is structured today, the technology that we have, the fact that someone can go on a cell phone and punch a button and we can receive millions and millions of dollars, I think Barack Obama would have said, I'm not doing super PACs. I'm not going to be part of a corrupt system of campaign finance. I think he would have chosen the road that Bernie Sanders has chosen. That's the right choice.
We have no way of knowing that. So let's move on to the questions that really rose this week over qualifications. It really got pretty nasty over whether or not one or the other is qualified to be president. Was it above board for Senator Sanders to flat out say that Hillary Clinton is not qualified to be president?
Well, Joy, I think he felt that he had to, and I agree with him, and I'll tell you why. Because after we won a decisive victory in Wisconsin, the Clinton campaign, through Jeff Zeleny, a reporter on CNN, announced that they were going to embark on a new strategy. The strategy was to disqualify Bernie Sanders, to defeat him. That disqualification strategy took the form of the candidate and everyone below her refusing to say that Bernie Sanders was qualified.
But she never said he wasn't qualified.
No, she never used the words. And, you know, I went to law school a long time ago, and one of the great things you learn in law school is how to say things without saying things. Okay, it was very obvious what they were doing. They were going to question Bernie Sanders' capacity to be the president of the United States. They were going to attack his qualifications to be president. They would do so in different language, but they did so relentlessly. And he fought back, and I'm glad he did, because if we didn't, in this media climate of a New York primary, I think we would have been overwhelmed. So we fought back hard. But we don't have to talk about qualifications. We should.
All right. Now, for those of you who didn't see the Morning Joe show, where Joe Scarborough asked Hillary Clinton, like, at least I'm trying to, I think it was four times. I'm for sure it was three times, but it was, I'm almost positive it was four times. I saw it, but I don't remember how many times it was. Instead of her just saying that Bernie Sanders was qualified, which would have put this whole damn thing to bed, she starts pointing out various things. So she actually did not say the words, but she was pointing you to things that should have or could have led you to think that possibly he wasn't qualified. So that's bullshit. Just like he said, you know, being a lawyer, you know how to get things said without actually having to say the words. And that's exactly what she did. And she did it three times. The easiest road to kill the whole thing would have been to say, sure, you know, sure he's qualified, next subject. And that would have been the end of it. So Todd's right, and Joy, and I know she saw the damn thing, and she's not stupid. So again, I think she's got marching orders on this.
Talk about what they're going to do as president.
But the candidate has a choice on what they talk about, right? So, I mean, you're talking about fighting back against something Hillary Clinton didn't say. Mrs. Sanders also was on Rachel Maddow and said, well, she didn't say it in so many words, but she didn't. Let's play what Bernie Sanders, on the other hand, said very explicitly about Hillary Clinton. Let's take a listen to that.
She has been saying lately that she thinks that I am, quote unquote, not qualified to be president. I don't think that you are qualified if you get $15 million from Wall Street through your super PAC. I don't think you are qualified if you have voted for the disastrous war in Iraq.
Now, Senator Sanders has started to walk some of that back. Emphatically, does Bernie Sanders believe Hillary Clinton is qualified to be president of the United States?
Of course. That's okay. What he said yesterday.
So he's taking that back. All right, let's move on.
Can I say one thing? Yeah. I mean, the Washington Post put out a story. Clinton questions whether Sanders is qualified to
be
president.
That's their headline. I've written a lot of stories. You know that's their headline.
I understand this headline. You want to know something? It's an accurate headline. They understood exactly what Hillary Clinton was doing, okay? Exactly what she was doing. And I'm glad they wrote that headline. It was accurate reporting.
Well, it's not a quote from Hillary Clinton. So
no,
I think we need to agree that she never said he was not qualified.
She never said the words.
She never said
but
that.
She employed the strategy in her campaign, put out that their strategy was to disqualify Bernie Sanders,
right.
And that's exactly what they tried to do.
But you're now saying,
see, now Joy Reid's trying to get him off his point, and his point is she didn't say the words, but everything that she said basically led to the conclusion that he wasn't qualified. So she keeps hammering on, she didn't actually say the words. She didn't have to say the words. She intimated that he wasn't qualified, and she then laid out various examples of things that she believed disqualified him.
Bernie Sanders didn't really mean it when he said she wasn't qualified. Do you see that is a disconnect?
No, I said what I see is Hillary Clinton's campaign attacking us frontally on the issue of qualification. Hillary Clinton's campaign launching a negative campaign on issue, from guns to foreign policies. That was their strategy to defeat us in New York. And what I see on our side is a fight back. And I'm glad that we did. Otherwise, we would have been beaten down.
All right, let's talk about some policy. We'll get to guns in a minute. But I want to talk about this New York Daily News article that has made a lot of stir.
Yeah.
And in which Bernie Sanders was asked how he would actually break up the big banks. He didn't seem to have an answer for that.
Yesterday I had the opportunity to read that because I took the train from Washington here. And if you actually
see, and that kills me. That kills me because Jordan Reed knows damn well that Bernie Sanders answered properly and that the Daily News guys were too stupid to understand the damn answers. And even after, you know, they generated the transcripts and went over them, they still didn't understand the answers. And Robert Reich has been on MSNBC at least 3 times, and he broke down that New York Daily News transcript and said that that transcript was completely accurate. Now, if she is going to claim that she doesn't know anything about it, so none of the shows that Robert Reich was on and wasn't informed, maybe that's why she doesn't have a damn show on anymore. But Tad Devine is going to break it down for her once again.
Read that article, as I now have. I will tell you, he explained his position, I think, very concretely in that piece. Now, I understand the media culture and the tabloid culture.
Well, it was a transcript. It wasn't media culture.
I read the transcript. Right. And let me tell you something. His answers are totally cogent. His answers make complete sense. And economists like Bob Reich agree with me on this and many others. What Bernie Sanders said about breaking up the big banks makes perfect sense. Now, I understand.
Okay, so then tell me, how would Bernie Sanders break up the big banks?
Well, as he explained, if you read the transcript, you'll see. There are several ways to do it. First of all, there's a legislative route, and he's talked about legislation. That's the preferable route. Legislation that would break up the banks. So we'll put a cap on the size of the big banks. Most of the legislation right now is 2-3% of GDP. There are other means to available as well. Under Dodd-Frank, for example, the Secretary of Treasury, working in concert with other regulators, can have the authority to break up.
You think they have that authority right now?
They do. And the question, and the other question, very interesting one, about the Federal Reserve. Leading economists are split on the absolute power of the Federal Reserve. They're not really sure. And Bernie pointed to that, and they said he didn't know what he's talking about when he said the same thing that many economists say. So listen, the coverage of that is absolutely wrong.
So you think the media got it wrong,
totally
even though
wrong.
He said explicitly, I don't know, and I haven't
thought
it. But he said that.
Well, and then if you read what he says in the next paragraph, he explains exactly what, you know, his understanding of the process. The truth is, no one knows. And he said, I don't know about a court case that had been decided the week before, the opinion of which has yet to be published. So let me tell you, the reporting on that story couldn't be more wrong.
In the case of what he said, when the Daily News asked him, well, what would Goldman Sachs or what would J.P. Morgan look like?
Right.
He said, I don't know, I'm not a banker.
That's right.
What do you mean by that?
Well, he meant by that, if Goldman Sachs gets broken up, okay, by the way, a firm that just paid a $5 billion fine for what they did.
And not one person went to jail. Thank you, Barack Obama.
In the housing crisis, if they're broken up, they need to decide how to break up their own business. They'll become smaller entities, you know, and if the 21st century Glass-Steagall is reimposed, something Bernie Sanders supports and something Hillary Clinton opposes.
How many votes would you get in the Senate for that?
Well, I'll tell you,
how are you going to get 60?
If Bernie Sanders is president of the United States, it would probably be 60 or 62 Democratic senators, so I think we'll get them all.
Well, there were more.
That's the electorate he will
bring
up.
Well, there was a majority of Democratic senators, for instance, on something that the base agrees on, like closing Guantanamo. President Obama could only get 6, not including Bernie Sanders, who voted against him on closing Gitmo, meaning that you can't guarantee that because you have a majority of Democrats, you can get what you want as president.
Of course.
Okay, so here she goes. So now she's going to try to play bait and switch. You probably would get 60-plus votes in the Senate in order to break these banks up. But, Joy, you got your marching orders, and I don't know what happened to you. You know, you used to be decent, but now I think you're totally in the pocket of MSNBC, basically not even following your own mind, and they're in the pocket of Hillary Clinton.
And I'll guarantee you this, that the electorate that will come out for Bernie Sanders, if he's a nominee of the party, will elect a lot more Democrats than the one that will come out for Hillary Clinton.
Okay, last question on guns. Bernie Sanders, does he still believe that gun manufacturers should be absolved from liability from being sued?
Okay, here we go again. You know, she's asking these questions and we already know the answer. Number one, Bernie he did sign off on the protection for gun manufacturers and gun retailers. Now, when he first signed off on it, he wasn't so much for protection on the manufacturers. He was for protection of the small mom and pop retailers that somebody might attempt to sue because a person who bought a gun from them legally and then went out and shot up a bunch of people, he believed that the mom and pop retailer, if they were not bad actors, should not be held liable. Okay, he has subsequently made his position clear that if a gun manufacturer or a gun retailer are bad actors, i.e. selling guns into an area where the guns are being used for criminal purposes, i.e. that's the manufacturer, because they could control the flow of their products into the areas that they want to. And on the second part of that, if a retailer turns around and sells one person 30 ARs and, you know, and 100,000 rounds of ammunition, red flags obviously should be raised there. Okay, in that case, the retailer may possibly be liable. But it, on any type of a normal transaction where a person just walks in there and buys a weapon, okay, and then goes crazy later on, uses that weapon for a manner that it wasn't supposed to be used on, that retailer shouldn't be held liable, and neither should the manufacturer.
Senator Sanders has signed on to a liability immunity bill right now that is in the United States Congress. He signed on to it in his capacity as a United States Senator. He says it's an issue we should look at again in light of, you know, the changed circumstances. By the way, he has a D-minus lifetime rating from the NRA from Vermont.
Well, they've supported him as well. They've been supportive of him.
Howard Dean's one of her principal surrogates from Vermont. He's an A-plus NRA guy.
But, I mean, okay? The NRA has been positive on Bernie Sanders before.
The NRA is the reason he lost his first election for Congress, because he stood up in Vermont, a rural state, and said, I support a ban on assault weapons. So he's got a great record on many of these issues.
We can definitively report that he has changed his mind about liability for gun manufacturers.
That he supports that legislation. He signed on to it as a co-sponsor. Yes.
All right. Excellent. Ted.
Now, I just learned something that I didn't know. Howard Dean has an A-plus rating from the NRA? Really? So that tells you that whichever way they want you to vote or stand, that's the way that Howard Dean is standing. And he's supposed to be one of the quote unquote good guys. All right. Now, here comes the interview with Karen Finley. Now, in my opinion, Joy Reid basically was attacking here as far as Tad Devine was concerned. Watch the different tone and tenor that Joy Reid has with Karen Finley. And watch the difficulty in the lack of difficulty in the questions that Karen is asked. Again, they're friends, so you know this is going to be a softball interview.
Thank you very much for being here. Appreciate it. All right. Joining me now for the other side of the story, Karen Finney, senior spokesperson for Hillary Clinton 2016. All right. So let's go through some of those issues. You just heard Tad Devine. Hopefully we were able to hear that interview say definitively that Bernie Sanders does believe Hillary Clinton is qualified to be president. Is that issue from the point of view of the Clinton campaign now closed?
It is, but I want to say, Joy, I appreciate that you attempted to keep Tad honest, because there was quite a bit in what he said that was inaccurate, that we have said multiple times is inaccurate. So I was very disappointed to hear him continuing to repeat falsehoods. So let me just say it very clearly. As you pointed out, Hillary Clinton never said that he was unqualified. It was inaccurate reporting on the part of the Washington Post.
Okay, so if you listen to the interview, Tad Devine said that she didn't say the words, but that she insinuated, based on the answers that she gave, that he was unqualified. So if you want to be completely honest, there you are, Karen.
Was asked a question about that interview or that meeting with the New York Daily News Ed Board, for example, about the banks. And her answer was to him saying, I don't know, in terms of some of the details about how he would break up the banks. She said, you know, it seemed like he wasn't prepared. I think that is a fair answer. That is not a strategy to disqualify someone. That story was absolutely false. We've said that numerous times this week.
Okay, and the answer that he gave, that he did know, was it had to do with the authority of the Federal Reserve in breaking down a bank. And the jury is out on that. So an answer of I don't know, and then later on explaining, because the jury is out as far as the Federal Reserve's authority is concerned, I don't know is a correct answer, and it does not disqualify one from the office.
Tad, you're listening, let's get that right and stop repeating that falsehood. And actually, I would remind you that 2 weeks ago, what we did see reported, and we saw people quoted on the record, was that the Sanders campaign was actually testing attack lines against Hillary Clinton. Now, I'm glad we've moved past this issue, and we're now back to talking about the real issues, like how do we create jobs, how do we increase incomes, how do we make sure that people have pathways to opportunity. That's what Hillary was talking about yesterday in upstate New York.
Apparently, we hadn't moved past it because you just spent 5 minutes relitigating it.
All right, so we campaign, is Bernie Sanders qualified to be president of the United States?
Yes, and she said so yesterday.
All right, let's go on to some of the other things that happened this week, is that the Clinton campaign seemed to be knocked off course a little bit by Bill Clinton and by some of his statements about Black Lives Matter. Does the campaign feel at this point that former President Clinton is helping her campaign?
Well, as you know, Joy, actually those two protesters were not with Black Lives Matter, and one of them was yelling, Hillary is a murderer. President Clinton spoke to that actually yesterday, and you know, he said, you know, look, I think that it's important that we listen to people. Maybe I didn't do that as well as I should have, but that's really what this campaign for Hillary has been about. She has been going around the country listening to people. She's actually met with activists from Black Lives Matter in a couple of different settings to really, because she wants to hear from people and she wants to engage with people and make sure that that is part of what is informing the policies that she put forward. And as you know, criminal justice reform is an issue that has been central to this campaign for Hillary.
Oh my God, criminal justice reform has been central. But it was her husband's legislation and her pushing that legislation that has us where we are right now. So if she was so hot to trot about justice and the criminal justice system, why did she push that legislation? And it's, why are we just hearing about her being so pro-criminal justice fairness since she initially started running for the office? Never heard anything about her jumping up and down about it then, but you had heard about Bernie Sanders talking about it, and be honest with you, you specifically heard about Rand Paul talking about it and getting together with Cory Booker trying to run something through Congress to get the laws changed. So Karen Finley is being disingenuous when she's talking about how long Hillary Clinton has been doing something. Well, maybe she's right. She hasn't been doing anything. She may have been saying something, but saying and doing are two different things.
It was the first policy speech that she gave right after she announced her candidacy. She's put forward a comprehensive plan to deal with criminal justice reform. It's actually something that she worked on right here in New York when she first became senator. I'm not sure where Senator Sanders was when she was working on those issues, but
I'm not sure where she was because I was back in New York when she was a senator. And as a matter of fact, my niece was one of her pages. But anyway, that's another story. And I didn't hear anything about her working on criminal justice reform. So I think that's a load of bullshit.
She got to work, you know, on things like sentencing disparities, like ending racial profiling. Those are elements of her current criminal justice platform. And she's also talked about and has a plan for how do we actually invest in the African-American community, because she believes that we need to take a holistic approach.
But Karen, is it not legitimate, though, to say that Hillary Clinton does have a youth voter problem, and part of it is tied to Black Lives Matter being highly skeptical of her on this very issue, in part because she did endorse things like the crime bill, said some unfortunate things that she has indeed apologized for,
yeah.
But doesn't she have a concrete, very real problem with young voters, including young voters of color, on criminal justice reform issues?
Well, actually...
All right, watch her circle the wagons on this answer, because she's going to halfway break it down, and she's going to lump the young black people into the overall black community numbers. Okay, and then she's going to lump them again, okay, into the overall college numbers. The younger black voter is not voting for Hillary Clinton. Her wheelbase is the older, over 40 black, actually over 35 black voter, and especially the over 60 black voter. That younger black voter, they have done their research, and they know that she's full of shit. But watch Karen Finney spin the answer and she does a pretty good job doing it, unless you know exactly what the numbers are.
She's winning African-American and Latino voters 2-1, 3-1, and in many cases, she is winning among younger.
Okay, see, she just spun that. She's winning 2-1, 3-1. Okay, but she's not going to break it down by age group. So, you know, she is right when she's saying 2-1, 3-1, but she's wrong when she starts talking about the younger voters. So she doesn't want to actually give you the full demographics of the vote of the African-American and Latino communities.
Voters of color, and she's actually doing a bit better with younger voters than I think is reported. I mean, in Massachusetts, she won almost all of the college towns. That wasn't really reported. But sure, I mean, we know we're going to need to close that gap if she is the nominee in a general election with younger voters. And what she has said is, look, you may not be for me, but I'm for you. And she's going to keep working hard to earn their trust, earn their votes. I mean, that's really what this is all about. That's what a campaign is about, is, you know, making sure that you are going to voters, you are talking with them, engaging with them, hearing their concerns. You know, she does, one of the issues that is key is college affordability. So she talks a lot about, she has a different plan than Senator Sanders. She doesn't think that we should be paying for Donald Trump's kids to go to college. So it's not just free for everybody, but it's free for public institutions, for middle class and lower income kids. But right. Also she's concerned about making sure that young people have a way to refinance their
right. Well, I know that we wish we had a lot more time to talk about these and other issues, and the criminal justice reform thing is a big deal, and we will see how these two campaigns that are ready for the fight are going to do in that New York primary. A good and spirited debate this morning. Thank you very much to both Tad Devine and Karen Finney. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for being here. All right, coming up.
That's Joy Reid giving her buddy a solid as far as a softball interview versus how she basically attacked Tad Devine. Joy Reid, you know, a lot of people have been talking about how you've changed lately, and I believe that this is a good example of it.
Campaign, is Bernie Sanders qualified to be president of the United States?
Yes, and she said so yesterday.
All right, let's go on to some of the other things that happened this week, is that the Clinton campaign seemed to be knocked off course a little bit by Bill Clinton and by some of his statements about Black Lives Matter. Does the campaign feel at this point that former President Clinton is helping her campaign?
Well, as you know, Joy, actually those two protesters were not with Black Lives Matter, and one of them was yelling, Hillary is a murderer. President Clinton spoke to that actually yesterday, and you know what he said, you know, look, I think that it's important that we listen to people. Maybe I didn't do that as well as I should have, but that's really what this campaign for Hillary has been about. She has been going around the country listening to people. She's actually met with activists from Black Lives Matter in a couple of different settings to really, because she wants to hear from people and she wants to engage with people and make sure that that is part of what is informing the policies that she put forward. And as you know, criminal justice reform is an issue that has been central to this campaign for Hillary.
Oh my God, criminal justice reform has been central, but it was her husband's legislation and her pushing that legislation that has us where we are right now. So if she was so hot to trot about justice and the criminal justice system, why did she push that legislation? And it's why are we just hearing about her being so pro criminal justice fairness since she initially started running for the office? Never heard anything about her jumping up and down about it then, but you had heard about Bernie Sanders talking about it, and be honest with you, you specifically heard about Rand Paul talking about it and getting together with Cory Booker trying to run something through Congress to get the laws changed. So Karen Finney is being disingenuous when she's talking about how long Hillary Clinton has been doing something. Well, maybe she's right. She hasn't been doing anything. She may have been saying something, but saying and doing are two different things.
Is the first policy speech that she gave right after she announced her candidacy. She's put forward a comprehensive plan to deal with criminal justice reform. It's actually something that she worked on right here in New York when she first became senator. I'm not sure where Senator Sanders was when she was working on those issues, but
I'm not sure where she was because I was back in New York when she was a senator. And as a matter of fact, my niece was one of her pages. But anyway, that's another story. And I didn't hear anything about her working on criminal justice reform. So I think that's a load of bullshit.
She got to work, you know, on things like sentencing disparities, like ending racial profiling. Those are elements of her current criminal justice platform. And she's also talked about and has a plan for how do we actually invest in the African-American community, because she believes that we need to take a holistic approach.
But Karen, is it not legitimate, though, to say that Hillary Clinton does have a youth voter problem, and part of it is tied to Black Lives Matter being highly skeptical of her on this very issue, in part because she did endorse things like the crime bill, said some unfortunate things that she has indeed apologized for, yeah. But doesn't she have a concrete, very real problem with young voters, including young voters of color, on criminal justice reform issues?
Well, actually...
All right, watch her circle the wagons on this answer, because she's going to halfway break it down, and she's going to lump the young Black people into the overall Black community numbers. Okay, and then she's going to lump them again, okay, into the overall college numbers. The younger Black voter is not voting for Hillary Clinton. Her wheelbase is the older, over 40 Black, actually over 35 Black voter, and especially the over 60 Black voter. That younger Black voter, they have done their research, and they know that she's full of shit. But watch Karen Finney spin the answer, and she does a pretty good job doing it, unless you know exactly what the numbers are.
She's winning African-American and Latino voters 2-1, 3-1, and in many cases, she is winning among younger...
Okay, see, she just spun that. She's winning 2-1, 3-1. Okay, but she's not going to break it down by age group. So, you know, she is right when she's saying 2-1, 3-1, but she's wrong when she starts talking about the younger voters. So she doesn't want to actually give you the full demographics of the vote of the African-American and Latino communities.
Voters of color, and she's actually doing a bit better with younger voters than I think is reported. I mean, in Massachusetts, she won almost all of the college towns. That wasn't really reported. But sure, I mean, we know we're going to need to close that gap if she is the nominee in a general election with younger voters. And what she has said is, look, you may not be for me, but I'm for you. And she's going to keep working hard to earn their trust, earn their votes. I mean, that's really what this is all about. That's what a campaign is about, is, you know, making sure that you are going to voters, you are talking with them, engaging with them, hearing their concerns. You know, she does, one of the issues that is key is college affordability. So she talks a lot about, she has a different plan than Senator Sanders. She doesn't think that we should be paying for Donald Trump's kids to go to college. So it's not just free for everybody, but it's free for public institutions, for middle class and lower income kids. But right. Also she's concerned about making sure that young people have a way to refinance their
debt. Well, I know that we wish we had a lot more time to talk about these and other issues, and the criminal justice reform thing is a big deal, and we will see how these two campaigns that are ready for the fight are going to do in that New York primary. A good and spirited debate this morning. Thank you very much to both Tad Devine and Karen Finney. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for being here. All right, coming up.
That's Joy Reid giving her buddy a solid as far as a softball interview versus how she basically attacked Tad Devine. Joy Reid, you know, a lot of people have been talking about how you've changed lately, and I believe that this is a good example of it.